Righteous God, we need your presence in our lives if we are to resist temptation. Send your angels to minister to us when the tempter comes to call. Put not our hearts to the test, but shelter us in your protective love. For you are our God, and we are your people. Amen. Now please take a moment for silent prayer of confession. God has heard what is on your hearts. You are forgiven. Our first scripture reading this morning is from Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 19. Therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death came through sin, and so death spread to all, because all have sinned. Sin was indeed in the world before the law, but sin is not reckoned when there is no law. Yet death exercised dominion from Adam to Moses, even over those whose sins were not like the transgression of Adam, who is a type of one of those who was to come. But the free gift is not like trespass, for if the many died through the one man's trespass, much more surely have the grace of God and the free gift in the grace of the one man, Jesus Christ, abounded for so many. And the free gift is not like the effect of the one man's sin. For the judgment following one trespass brought condemnation, but the free gift following many trespasses brings justification. If because of the one man's trespass, death exercised dominion through that one, Much more surely will those who receive the abundance of grace and the free gift of righteousness exercise dominion in the life through the one man, Jesus Christ. Therefore, just as one man's treasures led to condemnation for all, so one man's act of righteousness leads to justification and life for all. For just as by the one man's disobedience, the many were made sinners, so by the one man's obedience, the many will be made righteous. Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11. Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread." But he answered, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God." Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, "If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against the stone." Jesus said to him, "Again, it is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test." Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. And he said to him, "All these things I will give you if you will fall down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him." Then the devil left, and suddenly angels came and waited on him. Did the different forms of temptation the devil offered to Jesus surprise you? He didn't offer a slice of chocolate cake or piles of money or a one-night stand with a beautiful centerfold. No, the devil isn't working from a view of sin from our society. He doesn't concern himself with illicit sex, ill-gotten gains, or excessive calories. The devil is flying below the conventional morality to present a series of temptations that can very effectively cripple any of a relationship at their core. Relationships with creation, God, and people. These temptations are not concerned with simple loaves made from stone or jumping off a tall structure and a chance for world domination. They are concerned with what for us seems closer to home, such as matters of skill, trust, and power. Consider the first temptation, bread from stones. The temptation has to do with skill. Jesus has been fasting a very long time, and his hunger was severe. The devil, never one to miss a chance to get to us, appears and challenges him to prove his identity and to satisfy his hunger. He points to the stones that are visible everywhere in that desert. "If you are the Son of God, command that these stones become bread." And Jesus counters with words from Scripture. "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God." This confrontation is about more than whether Jesus gets lunch. Jesus is asserting his identity as the Son of God, and our identity as children of God, which does not depend on what we do or what we say, but who we are and who we listen to. Jesus is God's Son, and he listens to God. We are God's children, and we listen to God when he speaks to us. We have skills and techniques, but these must be used for the purpose that God makes known to us. Just because we are capable of doing something does not mean that we should. Certain choices, though technically possible, contradict what God hopes for us. They are not consistent with our identity as children of God. A couple of questions to consider. Do I look upon myself or others simply in terms of doing and having, or do I recognize myself and others for who we are, the children of God? Do I view my skills and opportunities as simply mine to use as how I see fit, or do I treat them as entrusted to me for our God's intention? Let's look at the second temptation, the one that has to do with trust. Jumping off a tall structure, the devil takes Jesus into Jerusalem to the very top of the temple, and he invites Jesus to prove who he is and all he has to do in a spectacular way. If you are the Son of God, then jump down, says the devil, for remember what it says in the Bible. He will put his angels in charge of you, and on their hands they will bear you up so that you don't dash your foot against a stone. And Jesus counters this temptation with his own answer from the Bible. It is written, you shall not test the Lord your God. The devil knows the words of Scripture, but he is ignorant of its spirit. Yes, guardian angels are commissioned by God to help us here on earth. But to trust God does not mean the assumption that God will protect me regardless, even if I perform some life-threatening stunt as an affront to the law of gravity. Trusting God does not mean that God will enable our stupid behavior. What it does mean is that we accept the life God offers us with its challenges, its risks, and its disappointments. It means living our lives and trusting God to make sense of them. For Jesus, this means that he comes to accept the cup of suffering that God offers him in the Garden of Gethsemane, a cup he would readily refuse, except that he trusts who is the one offering it. As children of God, it is not sufficient for us to simply trust God. We must trust God in the right way. We cannot expect God to endorse the products of our egotism as though the Holy One were a cosmic enabler. Not all risks are good ones. Some are ill-advised and destructive. Others are offered to lead us into the future God intends for us, a future marked by blessings. And here's another couple of questions to consider. Do I trust God only about my own wants and plans? Or do I trust even when God invites me to risk in a way that seems strange? Is some hardship in my life a cup offered to me by God, or a leap I have taken off a tall structure? The third temptation Jesus encounters out in the wilderness, a chance for world domination, the one that has to do with power. This time, the devil takes Jesus to a very high mountain that offers a panoramic view of all the countries of the world. Not only are the territories visible, but so too is their splendor. No longer does the devil raise questions about the identity of Jesus, nor does he have scriptures to misquote. He simply proposes a deal. I will give you all of these things if you fall down and worship me. Jesus senses that he has the upper hand and says, get behind me, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and you shall serve only him. For whatever reason, Jesus does not contest Satan's claim of control over the countries of the world. What he attacks instead is the propriety of treating Satan as ultimate. God alone is worthy of worship. Just as he does not condemn all technique or all trust when addressing earlier temptations, Jesus here does not condemn all power. What he insists on is that power, like technique and trust, must be used for the purpose of God. Power sought and obtained for its own sake, or power purchased at any price, amounts to devil worship or sin. Power must be used instead in service to the purpose of God. Each one of us exercises some power in life. Some of us may appropriately seek a further sphere to exercise power, perhaps through work or some form of community involvement. By exercising this form of power, we end up serving someone else. But for the choice of whom we serve is moral and spiritual matter of the greatest consequence. Where are the places in my life where I exercise such power? Do I worship God alone through my use of power, or do I worship something else? Skill, trust, and power. These themes appear in the story of Jesus, not only during this wilderness temptation, but at other times as well. Jesus refuses to turn stone into bread at the devil's request, but on several occasions, he multiplies bread when many are hungry, and people give up their meals in order to help others. Jesus refuses to jump off the top of the temple, but he does accept that cup of suffering God offers him, and does so because he trusts God. Jesus turns down the devil's bargain of gaining all the world in exchange of worship of someone less than God. What Jesus does is announce the kingdom of heaven to come to earth, and then dies and rises so we may enter that kingdom. Jesus makes it possible for us to decide about skill, trust, and power in a way that acknowledges his triumph. We are free to find our identity through our participation in him as children of God and heirs of the kingdom by grace. Yes, Jesus refused to turn stone into bread, but he turns bread into himself every time we receive communion. And here we are to share that meal as we trust in God and enjoy the taste of his kingdom. Amen. Amen. Now let us say the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. As you go out into the world this week, do not be tempted, but use the gifts that God has given you to help others. Amen.
There's a church in dear old Greenfield that's known throughout the land for its lovely lighted window with its inspiration grand. Many an evening as I passed it, tired from duties of the day, I have felt inspired, uplifted, as I've homeward gone my way. This window shows our Savior with his sheep, carefree and calm, as they know they're safe from harm. In his arms a lamb is carried. We are the sheep, and he's our shepherd. As we feed in pastures green, knowing if we only trust him, we may safely on him lean. Jesus tells us in his Bible that he loves us, everyone, even sparrow, sheep, and mankind, all that grows beneath the sun. Grant that as we view this window, we may strive to better grow and live up to nobler natures as we pass it to and fro. Bless this church and all who enter. May its influence expand. Bless the pastor and his family. May we form a mighty band. that will spread the gospel's story, further God's work here on earth, for without His Holy Spirit, there is nothing that has worth.